I think still it's not. Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. Let me begin today's session. And the topic for today is campus energy monitoring system. So this is actually a monitoring system we have done in our campus. So therefore, it will be interesting. It will be a little bit practical. And I mentioned my name, and along with me, I'm also mentioning Dr. Charan Teja. So he is my PhD student who recently, just a month ago, completed his PhD. And this most of this work done is part of his PhD thesis. So let's get into it. As the title suggests, campus energy monitoring system. That means you want to monitor the energy going in the campus. So CEMS. Now it is different from campus energy management system. So that is also CEMS. But then right now we are just monitoring, and probably in very shortly we'll upgrade it to even management of energy. So and again, as you know, the name monitoring and management are different. Right now we just monitor, and in future we're going to manage also. Okay, so with that, let me jump into the session. So briefly, I have these four parts to this particular talk. So solar plant monitoring system, building energy monitoring, campus energy monitoring, and multi-campus energy monitoring. So again, those who are here, feel free to pause and then ask your questions. So let's begin the first part, that is solar plant monitoring system. This is very basic, nothing very difficult. So we have a small 5 kilowatt solar rooftop system here, so as a part of our lab. So on the left you see the picture of these solar panels, and next to that is in the actually in our lab. So this is a battery system, and next on the right, the third picture is the inverter system. So right now I'm not going into control of this inverter and control of this battery and all this thing. Just the thing is, we have installed a 5 kilowatt PV panel. Is it working properly? Is it generating sufficiently? So to check that, we just collected the data from the system, and we are just simply plotting the number of units generated. So this is x-axis is April 1st, April 2nd, so on up to 30th of April. So this is the 1 month data. And on the y-axis, we have number of units generated. So for example, on 1st April, 27 units, and 2nd April, 26 units, and so on. So typically, in a kind of summer month, for 1 kilowatt of installation, we get 5 kilowatt hours of the energy being generated, the total energy over that particular day. So 1 kilowatt gives 5 kilowatt hours. So therefore, 5 kilowatt will give roughly about 25 kilowatt hours. Sometimes, little bit less, depends on the weather and all that. So that is what we are able to see. So this will be useful for roughly monitoring whether my panels are generating sufficient energy or not. You might notice that on 11th of April, only 9 units got generated. So this is, now we can ask a question, why only 9 units got generated on 11th of April? So that is, we can compare it with the previous day. Not only the daily data, if I go to the next slide, we have actually the within the day also the data. And the solar generation curve, as you know, at 6 o'clock in the morning when the sun sunrise happens, slowly the solar generation picks up, reaches a maximum of about 4 kilowatt. Remember, I told 5 kilowatt panels capacity, but even though capacity of panels is 5 kilowatt, maximum it generates slightly lesser, 4 kilowatt. That is actually normal, and depends on the weather. Sometimes, see, on the 11th April, there's a we are not able to reach the maximum. There's a lot of interruptions. This is maybe because of a lot of clouds or rain or things like that. So sometimes we may not be able to get the total energy. So this one. So, I mean, with this, I'll just briefly conclude the first part. It is very simple. Anywhere anybody installs a solar panel, there will be a system for measuring the amount of generation. And the person or the company who installs the solar panel, they provide you with this data. And you can kind of, do monitoring, on a daily basis. whether the solar panels are working properly or not. See, over a period of time, if dust collects on the panels, then slowly, you know, you'll not get the enough energy. So then you may think of cleaning the panels and things like that. So all the things you can monitor, that is a solar plant monitoring. That is not very interesting in the sense that it is very basic. But the interesting thing comes when we go to the second topic, that is building energy monitoring system. See, you are monitoring the supply side, but what about the demand side? How you are consuming this power? How much is the power consumed by different parts of the building, you want to know. So for that, we need to kind of set up what is called a building energy monitoring system, or let's call it BEMS. So let's see what this is. So briefly, I'm sorry, some of you who joined the institute this year, you could not visit the campus as of now. So you're kind of working from home and, you know, attending classes from home. This is how the main part of the campus looks like. On the top left corner, you have academic block A, and on the next, you have academic block C, and down below, you have academic block B, and, you know, all three blocks, A, B, and C together are in the lower right corner picture. This is just a part of the campus, not the entire campus of IIT Hyderabad. So as of this month, September. So just these are the buildings. So all the classrooms, labs, and you know, all the offices, etc., are there in this. So we have taken academic block A. That's what, again, you see the building here on the right. Though the power is supplied, you can see on the left here, the main power supply comes. And the power supply goes through a distribution panel. And the distribution panel distributes the power to different floors on wings of this particular building. And this is where the power distribution happens. And since it's a newly constructed building, which opened in 2015, so right now it is already 5 years old, but we still say it's a new building. And there are meters available here. So normally there won't be meters available for different parts of the building, but in this case, because it's a new building, as per new norms, the meters are now available, submeters they are called. And the submeters are all wired to one RS-485 to USB converter. So this is a Modbus looping, it is called. And the USB converter is plugged into a Raspberry Pi module. And the Raspberry Pi module it's like a small microcontroller, general purpose microcontroller, which can read the data from the meters. So a small Python program written in the Raspberry Pi module will read the data from the particular meters, and the data will come in the form of text with separated, you know, former separated string, which will be stored in the locally in this master controller. Not only it is stored in the master controller through Wi-Fi connectivity or through any other internet connectivity, I can export the data to a central server, and the server may be located in the same building or in a different building or in a different city also anywhere. And the server receives the copy of the data, and the server can have a database and a kind of a website. And using that website, we can visualize the particular data in real time. So this is the entire setup. This is a block diagram of the building energy monitoring system. So briefly, I'll show you pictures also. So if I go into the ground floor of this particular academic block, so the panels are shown. So you can see now in the panels. So different, there is a switch and there is a meter. So then again, there is another meter, another switch, and so on like this. So the supply is kind of distributed in different parts of the building. Now, if I further go into even more detail, the meter which is there is having a RS-485 communication terminals also there. So first of all, the meter has to be a digital meter, and then it also has to have this communication facility. Then from that, we can connect the data port, D plus and D minus, and then we have this RS-485 to USB converter, and then there is a Raspberry Pi module. This is a general purpose microcontroller, and by writing a small program, we are able to read the data from the meters. And then through this Wi-Fi device, the data is sent to the server. So briefly, this is how the meter connections schematic looks like. Let the slide change. So three phase four wire system, and on the right we have the supply, on the left we have the load. So that is how it is shown. And then we have three current coils on three wires, and then there is a neutral wire, and then there is auxiliary supply here going here, and then there are potential, like similar to any power meter or the energy meter, it will have three current coils for three phases, and then the RYB and neutral voltage measurement. The important thing to note here is that we have this D plus and D minus terminals from where we can extract the data. So this is how a kind of multifunction meter looks like, and these are the meter connections. So finally, as a result, we can collect the data and we can visualize the data in this particular form. So let me try and show you the real-time data. So you can go to this website. I'll briefly share you the link of the website also. So when you open this website, firstly, you have the presentation playing on this website, the same presentation which I am giving. So just simply scroll down a little bit, and under this different campuses, there is a real-time data page. So that's where you can go. And then just give a minute for the data to load. So I hope now you are able to see the data. So let's look at the timestamp to begin with. So the timestamp is 4:25 p.m. on 22nd of September 2020, which is the right now real time as we are recording this video. So and the data is updated every 1 minute. And total power consumption as of now is 233 kilowatts. So 233 kilowatts is being consumed by this particular building. There are 46 meters in this particular building, and all the 46 meters are reporting the data. Now categorized as plug loads on the left and the lighting loads on the left, on the right. And again, the plug loads, the building itself is categorized as a west wing and the east wing, because the building is oriented in east and west directions. So the west side is separate meter is there, and the right side separate meter is there under the plug loads, and under lighting loads also same. We have west wing and east wing. So we have terrace, seventh floor, sixth floor, fifth floor, and so on, like different floors. And what you are seeing these numbers, these are the active power consumptions in kilowatts. Okay? So for example, 12.4 kilowatt is the particular power consumption in the third floor plug load west wing. Okay, so like that, different parts of the building have different power consumption floor wise. We can see, and one of the major loads you can see here is the UPS system is 27.5 kilowatts, and HVAC, heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system is 43.7 kilowatts, which is like a huge one of the major loads in this particular building. So I'll try to pause for a minute. Before I pause, let me just go down and show you the load curve also. So I think what you see right now on your screen is the load curve of A block. Okay, so I mentioned the total power was somewhere around 233 kilowatt. Okay, right now. But the graph that is shown is the last 10 hours. In the last 10 hours, starting morning 6:25 a.m. to right now 4:25 p.m. So what is the variation in the load for this particular building that we are monitoring? Total load, I'm able to see. So not only the total of the building, individual meters we can see, individual phases we can see, all three-phase powers, three-phase voltages, three-phase currents, everything we are able to measure in live. And wherever you are in the world, you can visit this website and log into this website, and you can see the data about power consumption in different parts of this particular academic block A. And on the right, we have academic block C. Academic block B, not yet, we are collecting the data, but the website is not yet built for it. Anyway, this is still an ongoing work. So, yeah. So let me pause for a while here and let me take questions. So anybody have any questions on this? Building energy monitoring. Yeah. So feel free to ask some questions. I don't want to keep it to one side discussion. So just ask anybody having any doubts or you want any further clarification up till here, please feel to ask some questions. So you are able to understand this? No questions as of now? No doubts you are getting? So the question is this a part of CEMS? So is this a part of campus energy monitoring system? Yeah, so one way we can say the answer is yes. So if I go back to the outline, I'm sorry, let me go back to the outline. So the part two right now we are discussing that is building energy monitoring system. Of course, if I monitor only one building, then I cannot call it campus energy. So in a campus, there are several buildings. So if I start monitoring all the buildings in the campus, then it becomes a campus energy monitoring system. So that was one question which was asked. So any other questions? Okay, so let me move forward. See, not only we are collecting the real-time data, but obviously we are having historic data. So therefore, we can do something called load curve for the building. That means here you can see this is 7 days. So April 2nd, 3rd, 4th, up to April 9th. So we are having 7 days on x-axis. And on y-axis is the power consumed by the particular academic block A. So you can see some what you call ups and downs. So this is a daily pattern. So in the night, the power, since it's an academic block, so the power reduces in the night time, and again in the morning when the academic activities start, again the power increases. So then again the power decreases, again increases, decreases, increases, and so on. So you can see that daily pattern. So therefore, you can actually do forecasting and predict the power. Meanwhile, you can also see that on April 6th and April 7th in the year 2019, the peak is only less. It is below maybe around 275 kilowatt is the peak. Whereas on the other days, the peak is almost touching 350. So why only these 2 days the peak is less? So again, people can guess, sir. This is a weekend. So on Saturday, Sunday, again, we can not only see the daily pattern, we can also see the weekly pattern. On Saturday, Sunday, the power is less. So this is the first thing. So you can know what is the base load, what is the peak load, what time is the peak time, and so on. Now, not only that, we can also do what is called as a heat map. See, I mentioned we have the plug load and lighting load, right? So we have east wing plug load, west wing plug load, and east wing lighting load, and west wing lighting load. And then different floors. So ground floor, first floor, second floor, and so on up to 7 floors. Now, out of the total energy consumed by the building, now I can split the total energy into different percentages, and I can show using a heat map which part of the building is consuming the power. So for example, here you can see 18.7% of energy is consumed by the data center. So our academic block A has the entire data center for the entire institute. There are several racks with CPUs and servers, and a lot of air conditioning is there for that particular place. So the data center takes 18%. Similarly, the heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system for the entire 7 floors building, there is a central AC, and the central AC system takes about 17.9% of energy. So this alone, the HVAC and the data center alone, close to 40% is the in the consumption, and the remaining rest of the building, you know, consumes the power as per this particular this one. But the darker the color, the higher is the consumption. So let's continue. What we can do? We can do a lot of data analytics actually. So sometimes there is a over voltage problem or under voltage problem. So that we can analyze. And sometimes if there is a power failure, you can detect immediately. And because we have this building energy monitoring and excessive consumption at each circuit or panel level, so we can define that a particular floor wise, you know, this is the maximum consumption. And if it exceeds, we can again identify. Similarly, crossing of the maximum demand or energy leakages due to human mistakes or automatic SMS and, you know, email alerts for each block, you know, monthly reports or weekly reports, we can generate. We can also do a little bit of more analysis, break-even analysis, normalized consumption pattern, benchmarking, you know, weekday and holiday consumption, comparison of power consumption against the peak, average versus peak, you know, and then health condition of any critical equipment, billing calculation, and finally, accountability of the diesel consumption. There's so many things we can monitor having this particular data. So this is a website. I'm just sharing the link, cems.ith.ac.in. And or if you prefer, you can just scan this QR code and you can open this website and you can just briefly see. So we'll this is right now, it's a very basic website. We have to further develop this website, further add more and more features to this. But right now, as it stands, it's a basic website showing some data. So take a couple of time, you can minutes time, you can visit this website and you can explore it like this. So meanwhile, I'll again pause for a minute or two. Any questions as of now, whatever I discuss. How do we ensure that every meter is capturing data? Okay, so there was one question. The question was, how do we ensure that every meter is capturing data? So that we need to kind of monitor it again separately. See, my thing is I set the program such that every 1 minute we give a read command and we get the data. So sometimes if we don't receive the data, then we may have to make a note of it or send SMS alert, you know, meter number 32 is not responding or something like that. And then we can see what might be the problem. But as per our experience, once we set up this system and once the microcontroller starts working, usually it reads the data. Now, the situation is different when there is a complete power cut. So let's say there is an entire building power is shut down. Then even the meters are shut down and meters won't read. So therefore, there won't be any data. So if there's a data is absent from all the meters, entire thing, then it's an indication that, okay, the power is shut down and the power consumption obviously is zero. Whereas if certain meters data is coming, certain other meters, there's no data, that means there is some problem there. So we need to kind of monitor that. I hope that answers the question. So any other questions? So I hope some of you might have visited this website. Just curious, how much bill IIT gets monthly? Okay, so how much of the bill IIT gets monthly? I mean, since we are recording this, I don't want to say it right away. So, but then it will be in lakhs of rupees. At least it will be in tens of lakhs of rupees. And any engineering college, any BTech college, if you see, the electricity bill monthly will be in lakhs of rupees. And yearly, it will be definitely in crores of rupees. So, and by developing this kind of system, if we are able to, even if you reduce the bill by 1% or 2%, it will be still lakhs of rupees of saving you can do. And that's what I'll also show it in future in one of the coming slides I'll be showing. Yeah. So any other question? Okay, so if there are no further questions, let me move forward. So now we come to the third part, that is campus energy monitoring system. So basically now we are not just monitoring the building in individual building, but now we want to monitor the entire campus. So let me explain the concept first using a logical diagram, something like this. So here you see what we call as the levels of metering in a typical campus. So there is a grid supply at the top left corner. The main supply comes into the campus. Okay. Then there is what is called as an incoming substation. And usually for a large campus, either the input supply will be 33 kV or 11 kV at that voltage. It will not be a smaller voltage for a typical campus. Now this meter which is there here, this is an important meter because that is a meter which will build the entire institute or entire campus. You know, I mean, when I say campus, it can also refer to a commercial campus, to a company, you know, a software company or something like that. So with a series of buildings in a campus and all. So, but anyway, so it is like a, or it can also refer to a gated community or whatever. So this is a main meter from where the building is done. And every other green box here represents a sub-meter, which are optional. Sometimes there won't be any sub-meter. There will be just some of the colleges we visited. There was only one meter and nothing else. There are several buildings and all these things, but nothing else is meter. But again, that is optional. You can meter. If only you meter, then you will monitor. So that is a thing. So so like there is an incoming substation. Under that, there are several other substations. Substation means where, you know, you reduce the 11 kV to 440 or something like that. Then there is a building level and you can have a meter at the building entrance or floor-wise meters or room-wise meters. And finally, you know, individual rooms also can have a meter. So depending on the levels of your metering, you can call it either a smart room or building monitoring system or campus monitoring system and so on. Now, also notice there is a PV here. So PV means the solar power. Now this PV will generate the power and that power will enter into this substation and it may, within the campus, it may go to some other local load and it may be consumed locally. So in that case, the net power taken from the grid supply will be reduced. So therefore, your electricity bill will also reduce because you are locally generating your PV power. Similarly, this DC at the top right, this is a diesel generator. So sometimes, you know, if you don't have PV, you may have diesel generator which generates and so on. So this is a typical campus monitoring system. That's what we need. So so let's briefly come to IIT Hyderabad campus. So again, people who have not visited this campus, so maybe this you can have a look at this view. And people who already visited this campus in the past, you know, before COVID, so you might be knowing, you know, all these places. So on the top right, we have the dining hall and the hostels. And these are boys hostels, these are girls hostels. And this side we have academic block C, B, and A. And on the lower left, there is a chiller plant. And here in this region, we have a 1 megawatt solar plant. Right now, it is not updated in this Google map, but it is there. And right now I am located in this particular building where it is there. So let me just show the same slide with a little bit of labels. So we have ABC blocks and there's a solar plant and there's a chiller plant. And this side we have the mess and hostel blocks and like this. So zooming out further, so this is the entire campus. So again, you can see in Google Map, you can find this. You search for IIT Hyderabad, you'll find it. And this yellow line is the border of the campus. So total campus covers about 576 acres. So 2,600, right now, we are number of students is close to 3,000. That is the registered students. But right now on campus, we don't have all the students because of COVID. So eventually, when the situation goes fine, we will be happy to have all the students on campus. And the peak load is about 2.3 megawatt, installed capacity 0.95 megawatt, 5,000 units generated. And then the number of 11 kV substations is 10. And daily energy consumption is about 30 to 40,000 units. This is in the summer of 2019. Okay, so right now, because of this COVID and less population on campus, so the power consumption has reduced much. But these are the 2019 data. Okay, so the similar data in a different way. By the way, the red color dots which are there here, these are all the 11 kV substations. So the same, all these 11 kV substations are here. The same system what we developed for monitoring building, we are using the same to monitor even the substation. So therefore, we have the substation information. So these are the peak demands of different substations. So there is a 11 kV grid at the top, and there are two diesel generators and one PV plant of 950 megawatt. That's what I said. And then academic block, chiller plant, water pumping, and so on. These are all the 10 different substations with respective peak demand values in kilowatts as of May 2019. Okay. So this is again the information. So what we can do is have something called as a peak demand report. So this is a report. The left one is a report for April 2019, and the right one is a report for the month of May 2019. So this is how a peak demand report looks like. We have individual substations, and what is the peak of that particular substation, and at what time the peak has occurred, and on which date in that particular month. So for example, the radiant cooling towers, so their peak demand is 646 kilowatt, which happened at 6 p.m. on 16th May. So on like that. Now, 610 kilowatt is the academic block's peak demand, which happened on 12th noon at 22nd May. And so on like that. Individual particular substations, I know what is the peak demand. And the entire campus peak demand is about 2,351 kilowatt, or in megawatts, you can say 2.3 megawatts. Okay. So that is the peak demand in the month of May of 2019. Okay. May of 2020, we are in lockdown, so much lesser. That is a different thing. But that is it. 2.3 megawatts is a peak demand. Okay. So for reference, this is IIT Hyderabad. So if you compare IIT Kanpur, for example, its peak demand is somewhere around 10 megawatts or something like that. So ours is 2.3 megawatts. So you can just get the scale. That is only because of the student population. So eventually we'll catch up. So let me move forward. So this is some of the rest of the slides. I'll show some of the interesting observations from the different data that we collected. But as of now, just I want to again pause for 1 or 2 minutes. Any questions as of now you have? Please feel free to drop your questions either in the chat or directly you can ask. So, any questions, anybody? Okay, so if there are no further questions, I'll continue. So rest of the slides are very simple. I'll just whatever data we collected, we plotted and we see. There's nothing, no advanced analytics. That's a different presentation. But yeah, so here you can see on x-axis we have April and May month. So in the month of April 2019, actually, the solar plant was inaugurated on 16th April. So in the first half of April, there is no generation. But now you can see the generation started. from 16th April, and typically it is coming close to 5,000 units per day. Okay. Why 5,000 units per day? Because I said that 1 kilowatt gives 5 kilowatt hour. Therefore, 1 megawatt will give 5 megawatt hour or 5,000 kilowatt hours. So that is approximately. So again, this is slightly less than one. So about 4,500, etc. So that's what we are getting per day. And immediately within the first month, there was an interruption of 1 week because there was a cable fault coming there. So because of that cable fault, there was a gap. But again, the power started resuming in the June. So this is about that. Now, this is a plot of the load curve of entire IIT Hyderabad campus for the month of April 2019. So again, you can see entire 1 month. On x-axis, we have April 1st to April 30th. And on y-axis, we have the campus energy demand or power demand, you can see. Now, again, through the middle of the month, you can start seeing that orange color plots. So these are the solar generation, which started in the middle of the April, as we can see. So we can see the total demand, and part of the demand is met by solar system. So let me continue. So this is again the similar data for the month of May 2019, and here also you can see the monthly energy, monthly power actually. So the 1st May to 31st May, this is a day. You can see daily pattern, you can see weekly pattern, and you can see the solar. So let's move forward. So this is another plot. Now, since we have 1 megawatt solar plant, we can also monitor the impact of rain and things like that on the output. So this is one such example. The date is 24th June 2019. On that date, the power increased, and after increasing to a certain value, there was a rain, and then from 860 kilowatt at 11:25 a.m., the power reduced to 72 kilowatt within just about 40 minutes. So then again, when the rain started reducing, again the power picked up. Then again it started following the pattern, but again in the afternoon there was one more rain, and again the power reduced and so on. So this is how we can see how the rain impacts the output of the. So these are all series of plots I'm going to show. These are just nothing high tech, just the data collected, we plotted, and we are able to see some interesting influences. So this is the daily energy consumption of the entire campus. So you can see 30 to 40,000 units being consumed per day. And you can also see the PV plant generation. That is, you can see like the area under this will give the energy also. So we can, from this, we can calculate about 10% of our entire campus demand is being met by the PV plant. So obviously 10% energy from renewable source, there is definitely scope for getting more energy from renewable source. So we'll be definitely working on expanding our solar capacity in future. So some more examples. So here we can see on the left, the boys hostel and dining, the energy consumption in the month of April. And this is again in 2019 actually. So in the month of April, there's a lot of energy is being consumed. And again, coming back to month of May, the energy reduced because the exams were over in April and vacation started in the month of May. So we can see that pattern. When the students left the campus because of the summer vacations, so we can see the corresponding reduction in the power consumption. Same pattern we can also see for the girls' hostel. Now, coming to faculty housing. So again, in the summer time, faculty start shifting to their houses. So again, we can see increase in that. Now, this one again is the 2020 data. So impact of lockdown on campus. So we plotted 100 days, starting from 1st March. So you can see the initial part of the month, March of 2020, this is the academic block A energy consumption. As I was telling, usually the energy consumption of only that academic block A is about 6,200, 6,500 units. Now, the moment lockdown was announced in the, the end of March. In fact, the campus was vacated a couple of days before the official announcement of the lockdown, so that way students could have easily reached their homes by the time lockdown was announced. So that was good. So when that happened, the reduction in the power, we can see a significant reduction in the power consumption. But then, as I said, the data center is still on and our web servers are on, and also that's why whatever energy did not come to zero, but to keep the data center running, so some energy has been consumed. So this is 100 days from 1st March of 2020. Similarly, this is the another plot of boys hostel. So again, 1st March, 100 days. So up to, not 100 days, I think this is up to end of April. So we can see the energy, high energy is being consumed, and as the students started leaving the campus, slowly the energy started reducing. So from 7,000 units, the energy came down to 1,200 units or 1,300 units. So significant reduction in the power consumption following the lockdown in the 2020. Okay, so one more final curve I'd like to show, that is called duck curve. So what is this duck curve? Duck curve is the curve which shows the impact of solar. See, the blue line is actually our load. But because we have local generation that is shown in this gray line, that is the solar generation, the net effective load will be the total load minus our local solar generation. So therefore, the curve will become something like the orange color curve, which becomes like a duck shape. So that's why it is called a duck curve. So usually this thing is plotted for understanding the impact of solar. So that is the duck curve we also plotted. So up till here, any doubts, any questions anybody is having? So far, whatever I've discussed. So again, I'll just pause for a minute or two, take some questions. So everybody is absolutely following what I'm saying. Okay, so if there are no further questions, let me continue. So see, what is the point of doing all this campus energy monitoring? See, the point is, ultimately, we want to, without sacrificing on the comfort or without sacrificing on the utilization, we want to reduce the electricity bill. So here you can see, for example, we noticed that we have, like in our campus in Telangana state, there is a differential pricing. Differential pricing means from 6 a.m. to 10 a.m. in the morning, the price is 8 rupees per kilowatt hour. Now, after 10 a.m. up to 6 p.m., the price is 7 rupees. Then again, from 6 p.m. to 10 p.m., the price is 8 rupees. After 10 p.m., until the next day morning 6 a.m., the price is only 6 rupees. So there is a significant 2 rupees of, significant reduction in the price. From 8 rupees, the price falls to 6 rupees after 10 p.m. in the night. So because the prices are different at different times, locally we can reorganize our power consumption pattern. Shifting the loads from high price time to low price time will help in reducing, making some savings. So recommendation one, shifting of chiller plant from peak pricing, morning 6 a.m. to 10 a.m. So before 6 a.m. itself, the chiller plant can be switched on so that it will chill the water before the high prices come. So by that, we can save about 1,000 rupees per day or 30,000 per month or about 3.6 lakh rupees per year, like that. Another recommendation, we can go for cost of academic HVAC is about 4,500 rupees per day. So by selectively turning off some of the floors during weekend, again, we can save about 80,000 rupees per year. So similarly, another water treatment plant. Water treatment plant is something which doesn't run 24 hours per day, so we can kind of switch it. So there also we can get the this thing. So these recommendations have been forwarded to the institute management, and I think recommendation one has already been implemented, and the other recommendations will also soon be implemented in the day-to-day operations. So thereby, by installing this campus energy monitoring, we are able to gain some savings per year. So similar to this, several other campuses also can achieve this kind of savings. Okay, so that is about campus energy monitoring system. So we started off with simple solar plant monitoring. Then we got a little bit ambitious. Then we said, why not monitor the building? And then after monitoring the building, we said, why only be happy with one building? Let's monitor the entire campus. So now we are monitoring the entire campus. Then we said, okay, why to be satisfied just by monitoring our campus? Why not share this particular technology or whatever concept or idea with several other campuses which are there? So then, my student went to their BTech college, where they studied earlier. Similarly, I went to my previous colleges, and by typical general networking and making this kind of presentation, we got some more campuses also interested, and they came forward, they showed interest, and we did some implementation. So that's what I'm going to briefly discuss in the next 10-15 minutes about other campuses. So the question comes, why multi-campus? So renewable energy sources are being added at various campuses in a bid to reduce the dependence on grid. So not only one campus, several other campuses also started installing these renewable sources. So therefore, every campus is characterized in unique energy consumption pattern. So we want to understand these patterns to help in better achieving the above objectives. So therefore, campus energy monitoring system is a fundamental step, and IIT Hyderabad will be glad to work with interested campuses in setting up this CEMS system. So this is the idea. Then we had over last 1 year we had been working, and because of this again, because of this COVID, we could not get more work done in the last few months. But otherwise, we traveled extensively to different, over the couple of states, and we started installing this system in other campuses. So the process is, we visit the campus, we give this presentation, and we convince the management of the campus to release the funds, and many campuses readily agreed, because ultimately we are saving on the electricity bills. Everybody knows their respective campus electricity bill, and even if we can achieve the saving, so within the matter of 3 to 6 months, whatever investment they make in this particular campus monitoring, they are able to recover. And not only that, most importantly, the data that they collect from the campus, they can give the data, share the data with the students, and students are able to do their BTech projects or MTech projects with this particular data, analysis of demand and things like that. So these are some of the examples. And in the tabular form, we had shown how this particular meter, this is as of September of 2020. Later on, in the coming months, we may add more meters, and this slide will keep on changing. So please, so by visiting to this website, cems.iits.ac.in, you can get to know the latest information, what are the new campuses. And my target by the end of 2021 is to work with at least 25 campuses. Right now, we have a list of 10 campuses. And, to get work with 50 faculty and more than 500 students actively working in this particular project. So anybody at any college can install this, and then they can do that. So some examples I will show. So let me begin by one campus called VVIT. This is in Guntur. So this is the Google map of that particular campus. So the campus, on the right, you can see an engineering college, and on the left, there is a school. So the college and school both are operated by the same management. And so we got, you can also see the solar panels on top of these buildings. So this is the A, B, C, D, four blocks. Each block has a 25 kilowatt of solar panel. Then there is another separate building here. This is called a Siemens building. And on the top of this building, again, there is about 100 kilowatts or 150 kilowatt of rooftop PV. And similarly, on the school also, 50 kilowatt of rooftop PV is there. So again, as you all know, definitely for residential purpose itself, the PV system is cost effective. And for commercial setup and for industrial setups like this, definitely the PV panel will be very cost effective. And now almost everybody is aggressively going to set up rooftop PV. And when you have a rooftop PV, definitely you should have a monitoring system. So the school block has been handed over to for our team to set up this energy monitoring system. And this is a single end diagram. So there is a main supply coming, and there is a net meter. Then there is a 250 kVA transformer, and there is a changeover switch. The switch is in vertical position. The grid is connected to the loads. And when the grid is absent, that means when the grid power is interrupted, then the switch goes to the right side position and the generator will start supplying to the power. And then we have this main meter here, and then there is a solar 50 kilowatt solar panel, as I mentioned, and this different parts of the campus is shown here. And this is how the picture looks like of the panel. So on the right, you can see the distribution panel is there. This is a panel room. Now, if you notice, there are no meters in that particular panel. So if the meters are not there, then we will have to install separately meters on our own. That is shown here. We have separately retrofitted the existing system with a metering panel. And from the metering panel, we are collecting the data. So again, the process is exactly same as I explained earlier. In this particular presentation, when I was covering about building energy monitoring, the same system, Raspberry Pi module to collect the data from the meters, 1 minute data being collected, and using a LAN cable or system, we are able to collect the data. Okay, so let me continue. So this is how the backside of the metering panel looks like. See, again, the materials, everything procured by the institute management, and even the wiring, everything is done by the students and all. Only for installing the software, we help them. And there is one idea that came up here, that is, why not have a individual meters have a QR code? So what happens, anybody who is walking by these meters can scan the meter, scan the QR code of that meter, and can access the historical data of that particular meter. So what was the power consumption last day, last 1 week or last month, and things like that. So all of you might be having energy meter in your house, but that energy meter comes without any QR code. So in the future, it may come with a QR code in each meter, and anybody, any flat owner can scan the meter, and after appropriate, you know, login, password, etc., you will be able to see the consumption data. So that is going to be a futuristic thing, which is going to be interesting. So, but this particular project already it was done. Okay. And we can get a daily energy consumption report like this. This is an automated email. And if you look at the content of the email will show what is the energy consumed on a daily basis. So this concept was implemented by the students. So you can see the students in this picture, and they participated in one IET, you know, Institute of Engineers competition, and they also won the prize in that particular competition. Moving on to another campus. So we also worked with this Jean RNMI Institute of Technology, Jean its campus in Hyderabad. This is again a very well-known campus in Hyderabad city, and they have 160 kilowatt of solar as of now, but again, they may expand in future. So this is a single end diagram of the campus distribution. And this is a panel room of that particular campus. And in this particular campus panel, we have installed. So again, there were no meters. So again, with the help of the particular campus electricians and the students of that particular campus, faculty of the campus, so we again separately installed a metering panel. And all these panels, metering panels, will have a wiring to the existing panels for the, you know, current transformer things. And then the data is extracted. You can also see in this, in the top corner of this particular board, there is a small Raspberry Pi module which generates, which collects the data. And again, through Wi-Fi, we are able to get the real-time data of this particular campus. And this is how the daily energy consumption reports emails look like. So automated emails will be going to the respective principal of the campus or, you know, the electrical department of that particular campus. And they may be able to monitor the things. So here you can see, for example, this first report on the left, this is about 11th February 2020. And you can see the consumption of this particular system. So for example, the highest consumer, that is the ECE building and the ECE EEE building and computer science building, 710 units were consumed on that particular day. This is in the month of February of 2020 when the lockdown was not announced. And immediately the next plot, this is again a sample report from 15th of April. So if you look at 15th April, suddenly you can see only 19 units are being consumed. So we can clearly see the impact of lockdown from February to April of 2020. The energy consumption reduced significantly from 700 units to 19 units. So this is, again, in every section, every campus, we see the same pattern like that. So this is another interesting plot, which shows the operation of automated power factor corrector, APFC it is called. So basically, it is a bunch of capacitor banks. As the consumption of the power changes, the capacitor bank operation also changes. So here we can see 2 days of data. The first one is 20 January 2020, and the second curve is for the 21st of January 2020. How the step-by-step capacitor bank is operating automatically to compensate the increasing demand, and then as the demand reduces, even the capacitor compensation also reduces. So this is another interesting study. You can see how much is the KVAR supplied by the capacitor bank, how much is the power factor improvement, and because of the power factor improvement, how much is the reduction in the energy bill. All that things we can calculate. So let me briefly cover other campuses. So this is College of Engineering, Usmani University. This is where I did my BTech. So I was always, I can always walk into the campus, and then I was able to convince the electrical department of that campus to install. So again, this is the meter that they have installed, and they're able to monitor the entire electrical department building, you know, whatever power system lab, AC lab, computer lab, and all these things. And this is another campus in the city of Vijayawada, so where they have the main panel, and this is the layout of the panel. And typically, this kind of exercise we have to do, we have to, whenever any campus we visit, we monitor the, we go to the main electrical room and we map the meters, and then we get the data from the meters. So unfortunately, in this particular campus, we could not get the, all the meters, but only 1 meter. So again, this is yet another campus, BVRIT Narsapur campus. So in this campus, they took a different approach. Instead of we visiting the campus, they sent their students to IIT Hyderabad, and they developed a prototype, a small prototype system developed, and which can monitor the power in a particular, you know, lamps are there. So whatever is the lamps consumption, this particular meter is able to monitor. So the entire wiring is done by the students. So you can see the students on the left doing this particular, building a small prototype. And the project is, that the, you can also see the computer monitor here, how to extract the data and display it in the particular monitor. So this is a small project with 1 meter. And they have, extending on that particular work, this campus has also developed a 9 meters they have installed on their own. And they're also getting the real-time data from these meters. So with this, I'll conclude the individual campuses. And then I would like to summarize the core principles, that is what is the point of working with these campuses. So first thing is, this is a not-for-profit research work, and it's not a finished product. We are still developing different modules, and we would be glad if different campuses come forward and contribute modules, work in parallel and build these modules, and building a research community, developing research skills in different campuses, lowering the cost of technology. So similar technology, if you buy entire end-to-end system, it will be probably 10 times more costly. But if you build it on your own, then it will be much cheaper. For the faculty of these campuses, career growth will be there. You know, they can gain recognition for their institute, and they can do quality publications. And similarly, investment and growth for the campus management, and saving on the electricity bill, and spreading the awareness. So these are some of the core principles behind this entire initiative of campus energy monitoring system. Now, how to collaborate? You can visit this website. And once you visit this website, there is a button to contact us. So through that contact us page, you can contact and this thing. So I'll just skip this part. What is the benefits of collaboration? So first benefit, saving in electricity bill. Second one, research collaboration, papers publication, because you get the fresh data. Then student and faculty exchange between campuses, being a part of research community, and then any technology software developed can be shared across the research community. So these are the benefits. So a lot of people will ask how much it will cost, and there's a simple formula. So the cost formula is X plus Y multiplied by 5,000 rupees, where X is the number of metering points and Y is the number of data collection units. So you know that one data collection unit can collect data from multiple metering points. So that's why this formula. So for a typical campus, we can read all the meters with one data collection unit. So it will cost below 1 lakh. We can monitor the entire campus. So I've left some links here. So people, you can visit this website and you can go to this particular link and you can download the papers. And it's all step-by-step things are explained in this paper. So you can see this. And since I'm explaining about our campus, a brief, I want to also talk about myself. So these are the left side part is my teaching at IIT Hyderabad, and right side part is my teaching for the world. So I have a separate YouTube channel. So and this particular link also is there. So you can see some of these details here. Okay, so if you're not already subscribed, please do subscribe to my channel, and you can access some of these my lectures. So I'd like to briefly conclude here. I'd like to show a certain initiative. So since in the year 2019, there was no COVID, so we could do a demo and field visit. So probably maybe shortly in 2021, I will definitely do one more field visit. So people who are outside the campus can definitely visit our campus and see this particular system. So this was one event we did in 2019, a field visit, a presentation followed by field visit. And it was attended by almost people from 17 different campuses. So I'll just show some. This is the group photo of that particular field visit. So a lot of people visited this particular thing. So now we cannot do this. So group photos in 2020 are not possible because we have to maintain social distance. But at least in 2019, we did this visit. So you can also see some other photos. And it was we did a classroom session and also a visit to the substation. And this is how it looks like. So with this, I'll stop here. So any questions on this? So feel free to ask some final questions before I conclude this lunch. How much payback period do we expect for the investment in the monitoring system? So there's one question given. So as I mentioned, it depends on campus to campus. If you already have the meters installed, then the payback period is just 1 month or 2 months right away. But if the meters are not installed, then maybe slightly more. But definitely, if you install this monitoring system, payback period in any case will be definitely below 1 year. Whatever, because this is, we are all developing these components ourselves, and you know, we are purchasing the meters, and you know, with our own technology, we are doing it ourselves. the cost will be much less, and because of that, the payback period will be within 1 year. So any campus who wants to develop this, feel free to contact me. My email ID is there, or whatever, through this video also, through the comment section, you can contact me. And you install this in your campus, and within 1 year, because the campus monitoring system will have enough data. Through that data, we can generate recommendations, and through the recommendations, we can reduce the electricity bill. You know, we can find out the wastage, where it is happening. We can find out if there's any power factor problem. We can find out if there's any unbalanced problem in your campus. We can find out if there's any power theft. In fact, this case actually happened. We have one of the campus in the city, and the campus network is there. And it so happened that campus is attached to some other commercial shops and all, and they were actually stealing power from the campus. So they were able to, you know, jump into the campus sometime in the night, and then they connected some wires to some panels, and the nearby shops were stealing power. But because there was no meter, they don't know that, you know, this stealing is happening. So, but only after installing this campus monitoring system, they were able to identify this. Because in a very big city, in urban areas, all these campuses are closely connected with nearby places, and there is a power theft also happening. So we can detect that using this. And in such case, the payback period will be almost like within 1-2 months, we can get the payback. So I hope that answers the question. So any other questions? Let me briefly show you the website also. So again, you open a new website and then go to this link, cms.iit.ac.in, and you can go to this website, and you can see the talk itself. Whatever slides I'm presenting now will be playing as a slideshow. And if you go down, you will have what all campuses we are working with will be listed there. So as one example, I'll try to show data from a different campus. So this is the data coming from G. Narayana Institute of Technology, not our campus. So this is the, right now I opened the microgrid of that particular campus. This is how it looks like. So for example, if you see, meter number 6 corresponds to electrical department, CSE, and all this. Meter number 8 corresponds to the IT block. So now if I go to that real-time data, so here you can see meter 2, 3, meter 4 data, meter 5 data. Again, if you see the timestamp, we can see the timestamp is September 22nd, 2020. That is today's date as we are recording this video. And the time is 17:15. That is just about 5 minutes or 10 minutes delay is there for this data. 17:15. Right now the time is 17:20, something like that. So we are able to get the real-time data. And it keeps, and in this case, the data we are collecting every minute, but website we are updating every 5 minutes. Okay, so this is the data as of last 5 minutes. So as good as real-time data. So let's just see. Here you can see power value, minus 5.7 kilowatt in the R phase. And power in the Y phase is minus 2.5, and for power in the B phase is minus 3.3. So don't be worried about this minus. This might be because they might have connected the meter with the current in a reverse direction. So, but the total, we can see 11 kilowatt is the total power. Power factor is very good, almost close to 1 in all 3 phases. And apparent power also close to active power. And the line voltages of RY, YB, and B, BR, and the phase voltages also we can see, and the currents also. So one interesting thing we can see, the demand in the R phase is double that of the demand in the Y phase. So Y phase is having only 12 amperes, whereas the R phase is having the 24 amperes. So at this particular time, so there's a little bit of unbalance is there. So number 7 meter, if I go back here, you can see number 7 is actually the generator. Oh, I'm sorry. So since it's a generator, it's generating power. So that's why the power is negative here. So apparently right now, generator is operating in that particular campus. So that's why the power is shown as negative. But it's okay. So we can see individual meter data, all the real-time data in this particular thing. So if you go to case studies right now, the case studies page is empty. So we want somebody to come forward, access his data, and develop case studies, and we can upload the case studies. So anyway, so that is about this. And if you, as I already showed you, if you go to the real-time data, we can again see real-time data in our campus. So just give it a minute for the data to load. So now you can see the data again. So HVAC right now, it is consuming 43. So maybe once the evening happens, then the HVAC will be switched off. So the data, the consumption will be lesser. So right now the total consumption is 231 kilowatt. So more or less same as we saw some time back. So any questions on this particular topic again? Maybe I'll just conclude in a minute or so. So any final round of questions anybody is having? Yeah, so any questions? Okay, so if you don't have any further questions, then we'll conclude this session now. And those who are seeing this on YouTube can all anytime free questions on comment section. So with that, let me just end the session. Thank you.